Welcome back to our Jumpstart on Windows Azure Pack Infrastructure as a Service. I'm Simon Perriman, Senior Technical Evangelist with Microsoft, and in this segment, I'm joined by John Ballard. Now, let's take a quick look at where we are in our journey in deploying the Windows Azure Pack. Now, in our first module, we kind of talked about our quick introduction. We gave you the overview, some of the key design principles. What we're next going to really look at is how to actually go and install and configure the Windows Azure Pack. After this, we're going to kind of take you through the journey, through the rest of these different components. Now I'm going to turn it over to John. Why don't you give yourself a quick introduction?
Thanks, Simon. My name is John Ballard. I'm a Principal Program Manager at Microsoft, and I've been at Microsoft 18 years. For the last couple of years, I've been part of the System Center team working on this Windows Azure Pack instantiation of System Center as an IaaS engine. And we'll talk a little bit more in detail here about how we set up and install that stuff that you saw Brad introduce this morning.
Awesome. So what are we going to be covering in this particular session? Walk us through the agenda.
Sure. We're going to basically take you through the stack. And as there were a number of questions, I know that people are very interested in what it takes to actually stand up the Windows Azure Pack. I'll show you at a minimum what is required to make the thing minimally viable. Brad even mentioned how Windows Azure Pack itself is useful out of the box without System Center. But we'll go into details of what the different kinds of things you can plug into WAP are, and we'll talk about how to do that. And I have a partner with me today who's going to go into some detail about the Azure Pack configuration itself. Okay. We'll have a couple of goals for the session. We're going to basically take you through the stack from the bottom on up to the top. And when I say the bottom, in this case, we'll talk about infrastructure as a service, specifically Virtual Machine Manager and the parts of the fabric that are managed by System Center, all the way up to how WAP is installed and configured for the self-service experiences that we'll be talking about throughout the day. All right, so we talked a little bit in this morning's session about what Azure Pack is, and now I'm going to go into specifically the resources that are delivered by System Center that offer infrastructure as a service in this environment. When you look at a typical installation of Windows Azure Pack, what you will find is at the bottom, Virtual Machine Manager. It's the engine for infrastructure as a service in this particular case. I'm going to talk a little bit more about what you see on the screen at the moment, described as a stamp. It's ultimately nothing more than an individual instance of Virtual Machine Manager, and I'll talk more about the stamp in just a second. But you could kind of think of stamps as generally powering the fabric, and then across the top of however many stamps you might have, you'll have this programming interface that we call Service Provider Foundation. Now, Service Provider Foundation was invented a couple of years ago. Its sole reason for existing is to create a resource provider programming interface that the Windows Azure Pack enclosure can talk to, specifically talk to System Center in this case. So WAP makes requests through Service Provider Foundation, and then Virtual Machine Manager powers the outcome of those requests.
Do you have the details on like what exactly is required for Service Provider Foundation?
I do, and I'm going to talk a little bit about what constitutes each of these layers as we go forward here. But yeah, you know, at its simplest, the Service Provider Foundation is nothing more than a web service, which is powered by a web farm, an IIS farm.
And it simply allows us to hand off communication from one system or one data center over to another, right? So
yeah,
if we want to go deploy a VM in a hoster's environment, we would do that through SPF, is that correct?
Yeah, that's a great way to think about it. It's nothing more than a work delegator, and in fact, it's very lean and mean for that reason. It throws requests off to its underlying engines very quickly and then responds back, and so everything is asynchronous in that way.
All right, great.
Then above Service Provider Foundation is obviously the Windows Azure Pack components that power the different experiences that you saw kind of started anyway in this morning's session with Brad. At a couple of layers, the service management enclosure of WAP has its own programming interface as well. This is the means by which any resource engine can plug itself into this environment, and it sort of manages the conversation between the WAP experiences and the engines that exist underneath. Again, in this case, the infrastructure is a service engine powered by System Center. And then finally, at least what I think of as the star of the whole show are the portal experiences that we can surface as a result of this. And so that's kind of the stack in a nutshell. And that top portion is the Windows Azure Pack itself. So now for the next 10, 15 minutes, I'm going to take you through what you see at the bottom of this picture, which is the Virtual Machine Manager assets that power this stack that you see here. And then I'll go into a little bit more detail on SPF and how that's configured. So one of the things we like to encourage people to do when they set out to create an instance of this technology stack is to start by whiteboarding your cloud. And it's kind of important for a lot of reasons, but basically you want to have an understanding of where your assets are going to be, how big you're going to build this thing out, what your approach is going to be to growth and that kind of stuff. You know, at the heart of this is ultimately compute, storage, and networking resources. And so as a natural starting point, you think about what the compute space needs to look like. How many clustered hosts are you going to need, at least at the get-go? And now remember that depending on the density of virtual machines that you achieve in any given host, you'll have somewhere from, 8 or 10 VMs per server all the way up to maybe 25 to 50. It kind of depends on the kind of hardware you're purchasing, but ultimately you have to think about the initial hardware footprint that's going to power the management head, which is essentially system center components. And then you have to think about how that grows. As your tenants sign up and consume more virtual machines, they need to then have more space. And if you don't keep up with host deployments to maintain capacity, then their experience is going to degrade. So it's an important thing to keep in mind. And you also have to make storage decisions. What kind of storage? How much of it are you going to have? You can choose between SANs that are fairly expensive, or you can start the migration that everybody else is making toward the Windows file server and a JBOD approach to storage. But either way, you back your host with storage, and that's kind of one thing to think about.
Now on that diagram, you said fiber channel SANs, right? It's not just a hard requirement to only use fiber channel, right? You could use any type of enterprise shared storage, serial attached SCSI, iSCSI, Hyper-V over SMB in theory. Right?
Yeah, that's absolutely correct. Your hardware choices are largely up to you, and I'll talk a little bit more about this maybe throughout the next few minutes, but ultimately, people do seem to seek to standardize. They want to buy consistent hardware. Maybe they have a volume deal with some hardware vendor or something. But yeah, you're absolutely not required to use expensive SANs and fiber channel. You can go the cheap route or however you want to approach it. And you know, in cloud, sometimes the cheap route is the more effective way to go because everything is redundant and built for failover. So.
Yeah, and I think, you know, to kind of emphasize that point on the standardization, one of the benefits you have is if you buy all the same hardware, it's easier to service, easier to maintain, easier with your license and vendor contract. So there's certainly some advantages as you start to scale up to have that consistency across your hardware, but certainly not a requirement.
Yeah, that's right. Okay, so the next thing we want to think about then beyond the nature of the compute resources is the networking you're going to have. And I think, again, there's a lot of different choices for your network hardware, and I'm not going to get into those details right now. But at a minimum, you need to think about what networks you're going to need for your own purposes as well as what networks you're going to make available to the tenants that subscribe and use this environment. Then ultimately, you have to start thinking about how you delegate capacity. And in this particular case, we have a cloud-shaped image on the screen because the intent here is that you start to think about quality of service enclosures. And I sometimes make the point that a cloud in this situation is really nothing more than an abstraction that contains capacity of some resources. And that's kind of a good way to think of it. In this particular case, we call it departmental delegation, but that's really sort of an enterprise view of the world. If you were setting this up in your own private data center, you might create a cloud for the finance division and another cloud for the HR division and another cloud for the sales and services division and so on like that. But you need to think about partitioning, at a minimum, the kinds of capacity and resources that are available as opposed to necessarily using cloud as an isolation technique. And I'll talk a bit more about that in a second as well. And then finally, across all this, you might need to think about how to plug in additional capacity from an outside entity of some kind, another hoster, maybe a partner division within a company. It kind of depends. But there are a number of options for how to bridge the networking in such a way that you can essentially bring in capacity from other resource providers. Okay, I want to talk a little bit more about this scale unit that we refer to as a stamp. And a stamp is ultimately, as I mentioned a minute ago, nothing more than a virtual machine manager instance with its hosts that sit behind it to power the virtual machines. Now, there are good reasons and bad reasons to create a stamp, or maybe bad is the wrong judgmental word to use, but ultimately I think there are better reasons and less good reasons for how to think about when you create a stamp. And the reason we call it a scale unit is because ultimately we'd like that to be the main reason, which is you hit the limit of what VMM can do. And frankly, the top capacity of virtual machine manager is a range. You know, you can have maybe as many as 1,000 hosts and 25,000 virtual machines on a single instance of virtual machine manager, or possibly less than that, depending on the kind of hardware you're using to power it. But regardless, at some point you'll hit that capacity, and then that's sort of an arbitrary limit. You don't necessarily want to think about not further scaling of your cloud, so you just replicate what you have and you do it again, and you keep doing that as the scale grows. The first instance that comes up is going to contain the management components, and that's kind of where you start. Obviously, the first thing you do is you build out the environment, and you need the management components because they're essentially the engine that lets Windows Azure Pack power the infrastructure as a service. And so the management component of the first rack contains all the usual suspects from System Center. Then there's going to be the notion of a set of edge components, or basically the networking stuff that allows both cross networking traffic within the rack as well as north and south in and out of the rack to get to the outside world, potentially gateways to the internet and a bunch of other networking choices that you have to make. The compute thing is probably the core of this, and that's really just a big farm or collection rather of clustered Hyper-V hosts. And ultimately, this is where tenant virtual machines are going to live. Now, as my partner Sri will get into in a bit when he talks about deployment of WAP, some of those tenant compute spaces are consumed a little bit by WAP, depending on how you choose to deploy it. And then finally, again, storage choices that you need to make to back the hosts that that are going to power this environment. And then, after that, you essentially replicate the stamp, as I mentioned, each time you hit a scale maximum. And the one thing you'll notice here is that the management components don't need to be replicated each time. We have this idea that we can essentially span however many stamps are necessary to power the clouds that are being deployed.
Now, before you go on, I want to encourage everybody to take a look at our second poll that we're asking here. And our second poll is looking at when you are actually planning to go and deploy Windows Azure Pack. Is it sometime in the next couple of months, later this year? Are you already using it in test or already using it in production? So if you could please minimize from full screen mode, answer the poll question. That'll give us a better indication of how we can slightly tweak this training to better suit your needs. Thanks.
Okay, the next thing I want to go over is some of the networking considerations. Again, you could almost think of this as a whiteboard exercise, but in essence, you're trying to get a handle on what networks you're going to need and for what reasons. I highly recommend the use of virtual networks for your tenants. It allows them some measure of control over their IP spaces, and it lets them kind of bring their own applications and bring their own IP addresses and without a lot of what you might think of as migration headaches to get it there. It also creates an isolation so that essentially tenant one and tenant two don't overlap and have access to each other's traffic. But whether or not you let them have access to the outside internet is a matter of choice. In some cases, you totally need that. Public hosters obviously would have to have tenant workloads accessible from the internet. Enterprises may choose not to. If you're the NSA or if you're on a nuclear submarine, you might definitely not have access to the public internet, so you may not need the gateway servers and the firewalls that are necessary to give you access to the public space. Then you have this notion of the management networking plane. So you know, the management components that power all this thing will then share a network. As you can see here at the bottom of the slide, there's a management network that essentially participates with the main management components, which some of which are actually available on potentially a corpnet that's specific to the administrative function. So again, this is not intended to be what you need to know to go do networking. We do whole multi-day sessions on network and how to configure all this stuff. This is really more intended to give you the idea that you need to plan and different ways to think about the high-level spaces and concepts in the networking. Okay, so now before you start the configuration for infrastructure as a service, you need to have done some of the planning that I've talked about. So certainly a set of whiteboard discussions that lead to a pretty good understanding of the kinds of scale and what components and who the users are and that sort of thing. You're going to have to download and install the stuff itself. Now, realistically, you can start pretty thin. If you have just Virtual Machine Manager, Service Provider Foundation, and Windows Azure Pack, you can do self-service hosted IaaS. But obviously, you might then choose to go on and have all the other System Center components for the value that they would provide as well. And so that's something to think about after you get the thing up and running. And probably most importantly, before you sit down to configure all this, you need to know what your account strategy is, essentially your security strategy. What accounts are you going to use to back which services and resources, and how you configure all that is going to be fairly important. And frankly, that's one of the most difficult things that people run into is the aspects of setting up the right accounts on the different services and app pools and such, and I'll show you a little bit of that in a minute. At the bottom of this picture that you see here, we have step zero, which is download and install those components. And then what you might think of as the meat of this discussion is what you see as steps one through six. We call it zero to IaaS cloud in six steps. And in the rest of this session today, this session right now rather, we're going to do steps one and two. Configure the fabric, and actually the next session after this will go in much deeper detail and configure the fabric. So the rest of this session is going to largely talk about what's necessary to configure the fabric, and I'll show you a little bit about how Service Provider Foundation is configured to work. Okay, very quickly before I dive into that, I want to talk about the features in Virtual Machine Manager that essentially are, you could think of as pivotal to self-service infrastructure as a service. Now, at the bottom, we had to do some networking capabilities that were actually there for quite some time. These are not in any sense new, but virtual machine networks is a key aspect of having self-service tenants hosted and being able to manage their own networking requirements. One of the things that was, excuse me, fairly critical when we built Service Provider Foundation was this on behalf of administrative proxy. We knew that there would literally be thousands of tenants and subscribers hitting this portal doing different virtual machine infrastructure as a service things, and we knew that it would certainly be possible for the number of connections being requested to overwhelm the engine itself. And so what we have is a single administrative connection that the programming layer opens to Virtual Machine Manager, and then every time we invoke something in Virtual Machine Manager, we hand off the credentials of the requester. And so we have this kind of, I'm asking you to do something as an administrator, but I'm giving you the credentials of who asked, and you have to go check and see if their credentials allow them to do what they're asking to be done. I'll talk about the tenant administrator role just very briefly. The idea here is that self-service users have the ability to administrate their own subscription, and it's pretty flexible to the degree that essentially everybody is a tenant administrator when they sign up. And you can do things like add other administrators and essentially share a subscription in that way.
So we had a question that came up here, just someone relating it to Azure. So when you sign up in Azure, you need a subscription. Do people need a subscription to go and start consuming Azure Pack resources, or what's that subscriber model?
Sure, it's a good question. We'll go into this in a little bit more detail in session 4 today, where we talk about what subscriber actions are and how they pick different things that are available to them. You could kind of think of it as a two-step process. When I sign up for WAP, Windows Azure Pack has a registration experience. I literally go in and give it my identifier, which is really somebody at domain.com, and then I give it a password, and then I'm in. And at that point, I haven't really created any subscriptions yet. I've really only just registered with the system. The next step is to go then subscribe to the different offers that I have a choice from. And when I sign up, I'll see the different things that I can select from to do that.
Great.
And it's at that point that I can create some subscriptions. Okay. I'm not going to, these really are more here for reference than anything else, but I kind of want people to think about the steps that we'll take you through in much greater detail in about a half hour. We're going to go through a bunch of different fabric configuration. But basically, again, as I mentioned already, you're going to create compute, storage, and networking resources definitions, and then you're going to go in and define clouds that will essentially enclose those things and make them available to subscribers that will use the portal later than that. The one thing that you need to do also is to make sure that SPF, the Service Provider Foundation interface layer, can talk to both Virtual Machine Manager underneath, and that it also knows about the WAP API that will be calling it. So it has to have kind of bidirectional credential relationships with the other parts of the stack that I showed earlier. We also have a little networking cheat sheet. Again, this is not an exhaustive approach to networking configuration by any means, but there is a sequence of steps that you follow to essentially take what amount of physical networking assets inside the host group and take it all the way up to the creation of logical switches that will allow the host to act like a NIC for the virtual machines that operate inside that host. Okay, and again, we're going to show you a bunch more detail on configuration of the fabric in a minute. The next thing I want to do really quickly is take you through Service Provider Foundation and show you some of those working parts. And again, Service Provider Foundation, just to reset the context, is that layer in the middle that exposes System Center to the rest of the WAP environment. And again, I mentioned earlier when we set up SPF, one of the hot spots for questions that people have is around accounts. And so I've really brought some of those things to the surface here, and I want to just highlight a few of them. So first of all, SPF, as I mentioned, is ultimately just a web service, and it has an entry in the app pool, and you manage it through IIS Manager as a tool on the server. And I'll show you how that's configured in a minute, but basically you have to go in and set the credentials for the app pool to be able to talk to the System Center database, as well as to be part of the administrator group for Virtual Machine Manager. That's important. Go ahead and move on. There are a set of local users that are defined on any SPF box. Those allow the WAP API to talk to the Service Provider Foundation endpoints. And I'll show you those as well. I won't spend a lot of time on this right now because I think demo is kind of where this all comes to life. You don't have to actually do anything to enable tenants because, as Simon and I discussed just a minute ago, tenants create their own accounts. And so they'll come in and do that. And when they do that, we will then create user roles for them in Virtual Machine Manager that we use to maintain awareness of what they are and are not allowed to do. And then finally, I really kind of just wanted to highlight a couple of topological considerations when it comes to thinking about SPF. As I mentioned a minute ago, it's just a web farm, and lots of experience in the world for how to create and manage a web farm and the use of load balancers and how many servers. And one of the kind of wrinkles that can kind of mess with people a little bit is that the Service Provider Foundation interface itself has four endpoints to power two different experiences. The administrative experience is powered by the administrative web service, but the administrative experience also calls the tenant endpoint occasionally because there are things that tenants and admins do the same, like do a query on virtual machines. And so you have to kind of think about where these endpoints are going to live. It's very common that they all live in the same place. But if you're in a massively scaled up environment, you might see somebody do something like an administrative endpoint and portal behind some DMZ outer firewall with the tenant portal deployed outside the firewall because of the public-facing access that it needs to support. And then that'll create challenges for holes through the firewall and access to the database assets and that kind of thing. One little thing I wanted to talk about, multiple stamps. Again, I talked about how scale is a fantastic reason for why you might create multiple stamps. Another good one, and I saw a question earlier on the FAQs that were rolling by. Somebody asked about regionality, if I needed to keep my data in Canada.
Good question.
Yeah. So this is a valid place for using another stamp. I might very well have a virtual machine manager stamp in Seattle and one in Vancouver, Canada, and then I have a single SPF that spans both and surfaces that capacity up to WAP. And so that's a very legitimate reason for creating another stamp, data sovereignty, essentially.
So essentially, would someone say, hey, I have this stamp or this cloud for my US one, I have this stamp on my cloud from the Canada one, and then the end user, when they go and deploy, they will have that ability to kind of say where they want to place it?
Yeah.
They pick which cloud subscription, or is that right?
That's pretty much how it would work. Now, the one challenge is that the transportability between locations isn't what it should be today, but yes, mm-hmm. You hopefully through actions of the hoster, ideally through naming conventions and stuff like that, it'll be clear which region you're being mapped to when you sign up for stuff.
Great question.
Yeah. No, it's a good thing to keep in mind. And, you know, other stamps get rolled out for things as extreme as, or actually what I call extreme isolation, you know. So somebody wants their own stamp just because they want it and they don't want to take a chance of noisy neighbor or whatever else. And so there are other reasons why you see stamps being spawned. One last thing on the multi-region note is that you should probably try to think about avoiding massive latency. So I think, you know, having a Service Provider Foundation instance in Seattle managing a stamp in, Indonesia or something might cause you some problems. It'll work, but mm-hmm. But frankly, I don't think we have a lot of data yet on how far flung these regions can be relative to the API that talks to it. So
good clarification. Well, while you're switching over to the demo here, I'm going to go and answer one of the questions that I've seen already come up a bunch of times, which is, can we support VMware as the backend hypervisor? So the answer to that is natively out of the box, Windows Azure Pack does not. Well, you could kind of create some connections through Virtual Machine Manager, but it's really limited in what you can do. The best solution is actually going to be extended through one of our third-party solutions, and that is the vConnect from Cloud Assert. So if you search for Cloud Assert, ASSERT, search for their vConnect product, that's actually a utility that will allow you to go and direct, make provisioning, infrastructure requests back to a VMware infrastructure. So supported, yes, but working through a third party. All right, back to the demo, right?
Great. So I just want to show you a couple of very quick things on the Service Provider Foundation server itself, and then I need to turn it over to Sri because he's got a lot to talk about in the WAP space. So let's just dive right in here. I've logged on to the Service Provider Foundation box, which in this case is a single box. Obviously, in a scaled operation, you'd want to make this highly available. You could end up having a SPF farm with 12 servers in it. I've pulled up Internet Information Manager here, and I'm having a look at the different application pools and sites that are available. And if you want to dig into the internals of SPF, you can go in and see that essentially SPF is just a site. It has an entry in the app pool for each of the web service endpoints. This does allow you to set different sets of credentials on each of the endpoints. I wouldn't necessarily do that, although you might have a good reason to do it. It often can cause people problems, so it's something to watch out for. You can go and look at the site itself. It's ultimately just like any other website. It's a set of files in the file system. Oops, there we go. And we have, as I mentioned, four endpoints, an administrative one. The one called VMM that you see here is specifically for tenant actions. These other two are more about the enclosure itself. The provider endpoint is the way in which SPF and the WAP API talk to each other back and forth. When the WAP environment has something it needs to tell SPF about in an asynchronous fashion, it will use that endpoint to do it. And then the usage endpoint is all about collecting metering data so that you can support whatever monetization or chargeback scenarios might exist around this thing as well. One thing I wanted to show you really quickly, which is something that people do a lot of times when they set up SPF, is they will use an Internet Explorer browser just to see if the thing is working. And you can, as a RESTful OData endpoint, you can hit the, let's see if I can do this here, you can hit the web service and interrogate it, and you can kind of get a sense for if it's working or not. If SPF is properly functioning, you will get a collection back to any attempt to hit the web service. And you can ask structured questions like give me the name and the operating system of each VM in my stamp. You can also ask wildly unstructured questions like what objects do you operate on? And again, anybody who's programmed against a RESTful interface will understand how to get and iterate over collections of information. So that's kind of an important thing to do. People use this a lot. One other just note when you're demoing this thing, if you want to, you can use tools that can talk to OData endpoints. Things like Excel. I used to demo this a lot. I haven't done it in a while, but basically you can go into Excel, you can pipe in an OData query as essentially a URL with a select statement at the end of it, and it'll pull back structured data right into a table, and so you could use that for simple reporting and stuff like that. Okay, that's about it. That's the quick tour of the SPF thing. Let me make sure I don't have any... I think we're going to switch over to Sri now.
All righty. So one of the next thing we're actually going to do is we're going to go and ask you guys for another poll question. So this next poll question that we want to take a look at is, which as a service are you most interested in deploying? Now, we actually didn't offer infrastructure as a service because we are kind of making an assumption that's really kind of the first step that you're going to go with if you're thinking about a WAP deployment. The other types of services that we're asking you about are database as a service, platform as a service, as well as none. You're only just staying with the IaaS. And so just for some context here, database as a service essentially allows us to be able to provision databases such as SQL Server or even MySQL and be able to offer that out. Platform as a service is a very kind of traditional deployment model. This allows us to essentially deploy virtual machines or applications that are running and connected on existing infrastructure. So please go ahead, enter this poll, and go and answer these questions about which type of infrastructure service you're looking to get. Now, next thing that we're going to move on, we're going to change topics slightly, and we're going to go and explore the Windows Azure Pack fundamentals. So you kind of got some context about the background, the core infrastructure, and now we're going to really try to understand some of these best practices that are available. So I'm going to switch it over now, and Sri, welcome to the stage.
Hey, Simon, how are you doing?
Pretty good, thanks. Well, why don't you give yourself a quick introduction? Where are you from? What teams have you been working on? How long have you been at Microsoft here?
I've been at Microsoft for 3 years. Oh, I'm Sri Ramnatrajan. I'm on a PM on the Windows Azure Pack team. I've been here at Microsoft for 3 years, and I've been working on the Windows Azure Pack for about 2 years now. And I've been working on identity, authorization, PowerShell, and a little bit of extensibility for the product. So today I'm here to talk to you about how you can set up the Windows Azure Pack stack, what are the different deployment topologies, how you can get started with Windows Azure Pack essentially, and go in and talk a little bit about identity and how you can provide identities into the Windows Azure Pack stack.
Sounds good. So I think first you're going to introduce some common questions that we're going to kind of address throughout the session. Is that right?
Absolutely. So people who've been using Windows Azure Pack so far, they've been sending us a lot of questions, and we've been listening to them, we've been acting on them, and we've been answering a lot of those questions. So I wanted to address a couple of important questions that have come up essentially over the period of the release. So how many VMs are required for Windows Azure Pack? Is it possible to make Windows Azure Pack highly available? What are the roles of the different APIs? What is the difference between the different kinds of installs? Do we need a separate domain? ADFS, and a bunch of these questions. So over the course of my presentation, I'm probably going to be answering a lot of these questions, and we'll circle back and make sure that all of these questions are answered.
Great.
So going forward, What is Windows Azure Pack? So all of the components that are available in Windows Azure Pack can basically be divided into four sections. You have a portal, which is a bunch of self-service admin and tenant-facing services. And you have application programming interfaces, which your developers build their applications against. You have a tenant admin and a tenant public API. I will be going into details of this as we get onto our presentation. And you will also have a bunch of infrastructure services like monitoring, web application gallery, some PowerShell modules, and a bunch of usage APIs that can plug in your billing system onto the system. Now, these three are the Windows Azure Pack stack systems. Over this, you have resource providers that actually let you provide provision resources like virtual machines or websites or SQL, MySQL databases and Service Bus, which you will have to install separately from the Windows Azure Pack stack itself. So in this particular representation, I just wanted to give you an idea of how these different components are laid out and what are the different interaction patterns of these components. So you have the admin portal, which you pretty much use to manage your fabric or be able to create plans, add-ons, manage users, et cetera. And you have the tenant portal where your customers sign on and provision resources. And all of your data lives in like a SQL management databases, which is very different from the actual SQL databases that your tenants provision. So you have the admin portal that talks to the that have management databases. And you also use ADFS, or a supported identity system, as Brad was mentioning in his previous talk, for providing identities to the WAP stack. From the admin portal, you will be able to talk to the admin API, the tenant API. And from the tenant portal, you will be able to talk to the tenant API. I will provide more details about what these APIs are in the next couple of slides. And then you have a tenant public API, which your tenants can also talk to. And all of these talk to infrastructure services. Now, once you interact with these APIs, they forward the calls to the individual resource providers, and they're also able to read data from your individual resource providers. So, what are these service management APIs? These are very easily the most important components in the Windows Azure Pack stack because they abstract a lot of resource providers and provide you with a uniform service management interface that your developers can code against. So your admin API provides access to your admin functionality, as I said, and it operates on claims or tokens. You can use it for resource management, automation, or your portal integration. You can actually build your own custom admin portals and be able to integrate it against your Windows Azure Pack stack. Your tenant API provides access to your tenant functionality, essentially. It is also claims-based, so you will need a claims-based authenticated mechanism to get into the tenant API. It will provide access to all of your subscriptions once you're logged in. And you can also use this for panel integration and automation, where an administrator can, you know, view tenant resources and be able to manage it. That's what you use. Now, the tenant public API is essentially, you have a
Go on. I'll finish this thought, then I have a question.
So the tenant public API basically is what you use for your PowerShell modules, the Azure SDK that you can download and use against your Windows Azure Pack stack. It is certificate-based authentication. And the difference between your tenant API and your tenant public API is that once you access your tenant API, you get access to all of your subscriptions that are associated with you, whereas in your tenant public API, you only get access to that subscription which the certificate is associated with.
Now, a question here. We're talking a lot about APIs. Do people actually have to write code, or are they writing scripts? What type of actual language is calling these APIs here?
So these APIs are RESTful. They operate over web requests. So it doesn't really matter what language you're writing your calls against. People use APIs for different reasons. If you want to automate your deployments, if you want to be able to you can write PowerShell scripts that can make web API calls, or you can even build your own portal that you can offer to your customer. So they are actually agnostic to the programming language that you're building against. All they are looking for is a supported request, which will let them provision resources, essentially. So I'd like to quickly go over deployment topologies. What you see on screen here is data that you can find on the internet, so I'm going to really quickly cruise through them. We need Windows Server 2012 or higher. You have different modes of install, Express and Distributed. You will need SQL 2012 SP1 or higher, .NET 3.5, and IIS services, and a web platform installer to be able to install. So what are really the supported deployment scenarios? You have an Express install, and you have a Distributed install. Now, depending on your application or your use case, you're going to have to use one or the other. Your Express is a simple single machine deployment where all of your services are installed in a single machine, and you use it for developer and testing purposes only. Because this is not scalable, this is not highly available, this is just meant to quickly get you up on your feet and have you test your resource providers or whatever you're building against your Windows Azure Pack stack in a dev and test scenario. Now, when you want to go to production with this, you want to go to a distributed environment where you have all of the services that are separated across multiple virtual machines, and I will go over different ways of putting these virtual machines and setting them up in the next couple of slides. So this particular mode of deployment is scalable, it has high availability support, and you can scale out individual components to meet your particular demand or load balancing needs, and it also follows a high security standard, so you can actually protect your stack.
So do you have any like deployment recommendations, such as if I'm just doing a test, I would do the Express deploy. If I'm doing this in production, I would do the distributed?
Yep, yes. So when you want to start developing against your Windows Azure Pack stack, you would normally want to have it localized in your dev and test. You don't want to use a lot of resources. So in those scenarios, you basically stand up a Express deployment and start building against it. You will not lose any functionality by installing an Express deployment. What the distributed lets you do is to be highly available and actually provide fallback metrics or stuff like that that you want to actually have in your actual production deployments. So in this next slide, I'm just going to show you what a typical Express deployment looks like. As I mentioned, it's really quick to install, and all of your WAP services are available in a single box, and you need to use it for dev and test scenarios only. They are backed up by SQL management databases, and all of this are excluding the resource providers that you're going to build. John just spoke about how to deploy your SPF and VMM components. Similarly, you can deploy Windows Azure Pack websites, Service Bus, SQL, MySQL, et cetera, apart from the Windows Azure Pack stack. Now, going forward, when you actually have built your stuff out and you want to go to production with this, you might want to look at the distributed deployment where you separate all the components out, not just for security reasons, but also to be able to manage them independently. And I'll tell you what I mean by that in a little bit. So the way you separate your components out in a distributed environment is that you have a bunch of internet-facing or customer-facing services. By that, I mean you have your tenant portal and your tenant public API, which your customers are going to log into to be able to provision resources. And you saw a demo of this in Brad's talk earlier also. So you have an internet-facing tier, and then you have a set of highly privileged services. Now, as I mentioned earlier, you have your admin API, your admin portal, your tenant API, which are responsible for core provisioning of your resources that you want to keep under a firewall or keep it under your control. And you probably don't want to scale this a whole lot because you're not going to have as many admin users as you're going to have tenant users. I'd be surprised if you have more than 30 admin as opposed to 30 tenants, but all of this is set up on a SQL cluster, and you have your individual resource provider layer. So what I'd like to show from this diagram, essentially, is that you can deploy your Windows Azure Pack distributed install. If you don't want high availability, you can actually start deploying them anywhere from three virtual machines to a fully scaled deployment with like two-tier redundant, highly available environment, which can go up to like 12 virtual machines. So it really depends upon what your use case scenario is.
Now, when we're looking at high availability here, do you do high availability with failover clustering, with load balancing? It seems like a bit of a combination from both. So which go kind of with which services?
The individual resource providers have their own failover mechanisms that you will have to follow. From a Windows Azure Pack perspective, all of these are IIS services. So you would normally want to have your failback mechanism as you would do for any website or your web application high availability, more like.
Great.
So you can increase the number of servers for your high availability or address performance, and you can actually scale out these individual tiers to have more support. We've had people use Windows Azure Pack against your hardware load balancers or software load balancers also to provide a scalable environment. Apart from this, when you go to production, you will have to, what we recommend is you using Active Directory Federation Services, or ADFS, possibly with the combination of a web application proxy for your public tier so that you don't expose your domain-constrained services to the internet, so that you can provide enterprise-ready identities to your Windows Azure Pack stack. I have a couple of deployment tips. I'm sure you can get the slide deck through the MVA slides, so I'm actually going to really cruise through them. So you have you can scale your tenant portal and API for better performance, as I said. For high availability, use a hardware load balancer recommended for the public tier. You can also use a software load balancer. You can use always-on availability groups supported for both tenant and management databases. Preferably use a separate SQL instance for management data. You don't want your management information mixing with your tenant database information. That is actually the worst thing you can do to yourself. During install process, take a lot of snapshots. You might need to revert to them if in case you miss a step or do something wrong. Replace self-signed certificates. Now, this is very important when you go to production because Windows Azure Pack installs with a bunch of self-signed certificates so that you can just like get going. But once you go to production, if you go with self-signed certificates, you're going to see an ugly Internet Explorer cannot trust this certificate error pop up. So you're going to want to replace your self-signed certificates with a lot of enterprise CA certificates. And FQDNs. FQDNs are basically fully qualified domain names. When you install it in a box, you're going to have that box name. But when you want to go public, you want to have a www.something, your domain name.com. So you're going to need FQDNs configured so that you can expose these services to your customers.
All right. Well, while you switch over to the demo environment here, I'm going to take another question I've seen come up a few times, which is basically asking, do I use hardware-based load balancers or software-based load balancers? Well, the answer is you can actually use either. There's kind of a trade-off between the two. If you're using a traditional hardware-based load balancer, they usually have faster performance. So if you're doing high scalability, you may want to go and lean towards that. Now, the benefit of a software load balancer, where essentially that processing and load balancing algorithm logic is placed inside a virtual appliance or a virtual machine, that has the advantage of rapid scalability and deployment. When you need to go deploy a new load balancer, you don't physically have to plug it in, wire it up. You simply create a VM, and using your centralized software-defined networking solution or data center management solution like Virtual Machine Manager, that can dynamically configure it. So kind of depending on which model, you can use hardware, you can use software, and you can certainly use both to kind of customize them to each of their needs. We about ready for the demo?
Absolutely. So what you can see on my screen here is a typical Windows Azure Pack deployment. I have installed an express version of Windows Azure Pack, so you can actually see that all of my services are installed on the same machine. If you can tie it back to what I said earlier, we have a admin site, we have a tenant site, we have admin APIs, tenant APIs, tenant public APIs, and you have a bunch of monitoring, usage collector, usage, web application gallery. These are all the infrastructure services that I was talking about. In addition to this, you will notice that there is a Windows auth site and there is an auth site, which are the default identity providers that come with the Windows Azure Pack stack that will let you provide identities to it in a dev and test scenario. These are not really meant for production level deployments, so you should not be doing those. So whatever I'm showing you right now is from IIS. So all of these are nothing but websites. They're just simple websites that you have running on your individual machine that together contribute to your Windows Azure Pack private cloud stack. And as you would manage for any websites, you have your bindings that you can manage. And you can change this from 30,071 or 30,081 or 91, which it gets installed by default, to anything that your enterprise or that your company has restrictions to. So you can change this to 443, for instance. And I mentioned that you should change your self-signed certificates to a public CA certificate. Here's how you do it. When it installs with a bunch of self-signed certificates. And I've gone on ahead and I've gotten a CA certificate, and I've assigned this to my environment. We also have configuration PowerShell commandlets, which I'm going to get into. So Windows Azure Pack essentially comes with a set of admin and config PowerShell commandlets. There are about 44 configuration PowerShell commandlets that you have available, including the ones where you can actually get a list of admin users, decide which of your admin users that you want to give access to your admin portal, configure your FQDNs, as I just said, and be able to manage your core configuration just from a pure automation and PowerShell perspective. That, I'm going to switch back to my slide.
Great. Well, while you do that, another question has come up here a few times as well, and that is how many virtual machines are actually required for this WAP installation? Now, really, the answer to that kind of depends on your scale and your needs. You can actually get it down to as small as 3 virtual machines if you want, really designed for kind of a test environment, or a dozen or more, depending on how much you want to scale out and whether you want to separate and isolate each of the different components. Now, when you're thinking about scaling out as well, really you want to think about scaling out that front tier where you have multiple client connections coming in to make self-service requests, and that would be scaled out and generally placed behind a load balancer. So no perfect answer, it depends. All right, so the next question that we're going to get here, we're almost resolved these, is around how do I actually get the SQL Server itself? Now, if you actually go and purchase a System Center 2012 license, one of the things you get as part of that is the SQL Server license, SQL Server Standard Edition. So you want to keep in mind that this gives you the ability to run System Center. So we have a question now. If I already have a SQL Server license, can I use that same SQL Server to actually store my WAP database information as well?
Yes, you absolutely can. If you already have a SQL Server license, you can install your Windows Azure Pack on top of it and use it for your management configuration information, as well as if you have, as well as be able to add that SQL Server to be able to provide your tenant databases also.
Great.
So I'd like to go on a little bit about the extensibility part of it, the setup. Windows Azure Pack has a bunch of extensibility points, both in terms of a runtime perspective and also in terms of setup. A couple of these are multiple tenant portals. You will be able to set up multiple instances of these tenant portals to cater to completely different, as we'd like to call them, tenants or customers, and be able to theme them or be able to provide different identity providers to access the environment. This is, we've seen a lot of people go towards the second part, which is basically a host header-based theming of the tenant portal, which basically means that depending on what the host header is in your incoming tenant portal, you will be able to theme the portal differently and be able to like cater to different customers or have them provide to different identity providers. Now, we've been talking a lot about identity, so I'd like to talk a little bit more on what identity is and how you actually expose identity through the Windows Azure Pack stack and give you a general idea or lay of the land, if you will, on what it takes to set up identity with Windows Azure Pack stack. So, as Brad earlier mentioned, Windows Azure Pack is basically a claims-based authentication system using JWT tokens, and you will be able to provide federated identities through Active Directory Federation services. Now, when we say claims-based authentication, a lot of people are new to claims-based authentication. So when we talk about Kerberos, it is basically something that comes up when you currently log into your Windows system and is local to that particular system. But when you're talking about a highly scalable or a highly distributed environment, you're going to need to have credentials that flow, even in some cases, even through the internet. And so we resort to a more sophisticated internet-friendly protocols set, which Windows Azure Pack uses. For now, we use WS Federation and WS Trust, which will let you generate JWT tokens. And having ADFS in there basically makes it very easier for you, as ADFS is very robust in supporting these protocols and being able to provision identities both in Active Directory and through other identity providers also. Now, when I say other identity providers, it could be another ADFS instance or your own identity store that can actually have an SDS head. As Brad mentioned, you had parallels that have their own SDS and their own identity system. Or if you already have a cloud-based identity in Azure Active Directory, or you have an ACS instance that is actually available in Windows Azure, you will be able to directly federate that with your on-premise Active Directory and be able to provision identities directly from the cloud, even to your on-premise stack. Before we get into details on how to set up identity, I would like to give you a brief definition. So I'm going to be using these words a lot in the next couple of slides, so I just want to set level set on what these terms are. So you'll be hearing from me relying party, a federation service, an identity provider a lot. In the context of this conversation, a relying party is your Windows Azure Pack portal. The federation service is your ADFS, and an identity provider can be a third-party SDS or ACS or Azure Active Directory, as I just mentioned. What is federated identity? A federated identity is basically the means of linking a person's electronic identity attributes stored across multiple distinct identity management systems, which is a long-winded way of saying, if you have an application and you have your identity coming from somewhere else, how do you actually make sure that this identity will be able to talk to this application? Identity is who I am, and authorization is basically what I have access to, right? So if you look at my slide deck here, the animation will tell you that I have an application which encases your Windows Azure Pack stack, and my identity or my organization is Contoso, where I have a user ID, password, or login credentials in. Now, this application is guarded by an ADFS instance, typically set up by the organization that's actually hosting this application. And what happens right now is that I need to set up a trust between ADFS and Contoso so that somebody from my Contoso instance will be able to log into my Windows Azure Pack instance. This is called federation. And if you have a number of STSs or your federation services in between, this is called a federation chain. I'd like to explain federation in a very understandable terms, where you say a federated login is very much the same as you boarding a plane. So a user, or you're a traveler at this point, want to get access or get onto a plane. At this point, the people who can help you do this are a ticketing agent, a check-in agent, and a gate agent who you'll have to go through to get to the plane. So a typical flow, and I know all of you have done this before, I'd be surprised if you haven't done this to board a plane, but typically you go to a ticketing agent, give them your credit card, or if you've been traveling with the airline enough, you kind of give them your miles, and they give you a ticket. You take this ticket, go to the check-in agent at the airport, and he validates the ticket, makes sure it's authentic, and gives you a boarding pass. You take this boarding pass to the gate agent, who again validates it to make sure it's a valid boarding pass for that plane that you actually are boarding, and gives you access to the plane.
Now, you missed one important step. Hopefully, it's not as slow as a real airport where you have to wait an hour when you're going through security, right? We're going a little faster than that.
This is going to be really fast.
Okay, good.
You're going to see a bunch of redirects, and you're actually going to get access to your application really fast.
Nice.
Now, if you take your ticket to the gate agent, he's going to be like, hey, I have no idea what this is. Or if you're going to take your boarding pass to your check-in agent, he's going to be like, I don't take boarding passes. So what I'm trying to convey is that anybody who's issuing an artifact in the previous part of the chain will not work anywhere else but the next part of the chain. That is an important point to have in mind when we're talking about federated identity. So I have a bunch of resources that I need access to, virtual machines, websites, what have you. And I have my identity at contoso.com or my enterprise Active Directory. I have the WAP portal that's going to let me provision these resources. And I have a WAP STS that lets me have access authenticate into the WAP portal. So I go to my WAP, my Contoso STS. I give it my credentials. I get a token back. Now I have to take this token back to WAP STS, get back a WAP token, and provision that and provide that WAP token to the WAP portal to get access to my resources. So the reason I'm telling you this is because one of the common questions that we've been getting is that, hey, I go to my WAP tenant portal or I go to my WAP admin portal and it randomly redirects me to a bunch of places and brings me back to my WAP portal again. What is that really about? So if you look at the diagram here, so I have my WAP portal, and as I mentioned, if you take a token that is not meant for the WAP portal to the WAP portal, it is not going to let you in. So when you go to the WAP portal without any token, it's going to be like, hey, this is your STS. You know, go get a token that I recognize, and I will give you access essentially to my resources, right? So you get redirected to your identity provider, you kind of sign in, and then once you sign in, you're redirected back to your portal, and you get access to your resources. What happens next is, like, once you have your dev and test scenarios all set up and you want to go to your production environment, you have Active Directory Federation Services that needs to come into play. So this next slide, I'm going to talk about what is it that you have to do to configure ADFS, right? So this is your typical WAP deployment. You have your Windows Azure Pack admin portal talk to your admin authentication site. You have your tenant portal talk to your tenant authentication site. And now you need to have ADFS in between. So what you're really doing is that you're configuring your management portals to trust ADFS. And the PowerShell command that you use to do that is listed right below. What you're doing here is that saying, hey, admin portal, do not redirect the user to the admin auth site. Instead, redirect them to ADFS. Right, and same thing for the tenant portal. Once you're done with that, you're going to tell ADFS, hey, now ADFS is a highly secure system. It's not going to authenticate randomly anybody or randomly authenticate any application. It's going to authenticate if the request is made by an application it understands for obvious security reasons. So the second step is to tell ADFS that, hey, the WAP admin portal and the WAP tenant portal will be requesting for resources or authentication. That is what you do by an add ADFS relying party trust PowerShell commandlet or doing it through the UI, telling it that the WAP admin or tenant portal is going to need access. Additionally, you can also tell it that, hey, the WAP admin portal needs access through Active Directory. So when somebody comes in from the admin portal, directly show them the Active Directory login page so they can actually enter their credentials. Now, for the tenants, you don't want your admin and your tenants to be on the same Active Directory. So you're going to need a separate identity system. In this case, I'm going to use the inbuilt tenant authentication site that comes with the product as an example. But in reality, you have probably have your customer's Active Directory, or you have another identity system that you'd like to plug into the Windows Azure Pack stack to provide tenant identities. So the third step, what you'll be doing is that you're going to run a set management service identity provider settings PowerShell commandlet that will tell ADFS that when tenants log in, authenticate them through the tenant authentication site. And similar to what we did with ADFS, you need to tell the tenant auth site that ADFS is going to be requesting for identities because simply it cannot authenticate just anybody. So you're going to establish a two-way trust and saying the tenant authentication site, if ADFS requests tokens, give it tokens and redirect back. Now, all of this information is available in the TechNet link that I have available on screen. So you'll be able to go in and read up on detail on all of this.
Great. Well, while you switch over to that demo, I have a question here. Can I have some users authenticate through both ADFS and the tenant authentication site simultaneously? And the answer to that is yes. Like, using ADFS, we can actually have multiple identity providers assigned to the same relaying party. So you can actually set it up so that when someone logs in, they're actually given a choice to pick which of these different identity systems. However, you have to keep in mind that the tenant authentication site is not scalable, and so it's really not meant to be deployed in production scenarios. So keep that in mind. Production, you really want to make sure that you use ADFS and kind of those key supported login scenarios.
So we're back to our demo system, and I talked about a couple of commandlets that it takes to basically set up your Active Directory system. So I'm going to show you what it looks like or what the manageability is once you've set it up. As I said, we have our admin site and our tenant site essentially plugged into ADFS. In this particular environment, I have a tenant site, which is my Contoso WAP, that's plugged into ADFS. And I can see it in the relying party trust. Now, this is just an ADFS MMC console that you can open up to manage your resources. And you have your claims provider trust, where I've added my tenant authentication site, which is called Fabricam in this case, to my ADFS. And I also have ADFS authenticating against my Active Directory, right? So what this looks like is that I have a user. I'm going to open my Active Directory management console here to see that I have a user called John Doe, who is in my Active Directory that likes to access the Windows Azure Pack portal. And I have a dev team security group that I'd want to have access to. So I'm going to go here, and I'm going to open my tenant portal. So this is my tenant portal. When I'm opening it, now the tenant portal has been set up in such a way that it knows that it needs to provide identity through my Contoso Active Directory. So this is now redirecting me to my Active Directory Federation Services or ADFS's login page so that I can log in with my Contoso credentials. So it's WAP/ I couldn't come up with a more generic name than John Doe, but
you're John Doe, huh? Okay.
So I'm going to log in with my credentials. And now what this is doing is that it is taking me back to my Windows Azure Pack portal. And once it opens up, you will see that it is going to give me access. While that's loading, I can also give you another demo to say that I have federated identities, right? So I told you that ADFS can actually redirect me to another identity provider for login. So I'm going to enter Fabricam, which is another identity provider, which is another, sorry, tenant portal. And I've set up my ADFS to directly take me to a tenant authentication site when somebody from Fabricam logs in. So when I do this, I'm directly taken to my tenant authentication site. Now, this is actually going through ADFS and to the tenant authentication site. So I can have Shane Austin. Log in as well.
What about Jane Doe?
Oh, I forgot her. I'm sorry. So that basically is the end of my demo. So what you basically saw here was that somebody going to the tenant portal, being authenticated through ADFS, and being redirected back to the tenant portal so that they can get access to the resources through their enterprise identity.
Excellent. Great. Well, as we wrap up here, we had just want to give you share some results from the last poll we had. We asked, besides IaaS, which WAP service are you most interested in deploying? And so about 30% of you said IaaS only. About 40% of you said, I want to do platform as a service as well. And about another 30% of you said, I want to do database as a service as well. So that's really interesting. We made an assumption, maybe wrongly, that we thought everyone would really be focused on mostly just doing IaaS, but it sounds like there's definitely a demand for these other components. And we'll touch a little more on them in our next section. So as we wrap this module up, I want to just remind you of a few resources that we have. We again have the TechNet Virtual Labs for hands-on. We have the Microsoft Virtual Academy for continual training. And we have the TechNet Evaluation Center to download. Well, Sri, thank you so much for joining me. That was great. I also want to thank John as well. He'll be coming back a little later today. And with that, we'll take a 10-minute break, and we will be back to discuss deploying and managing your fabric. Thank you.